Welcome to the Sewing Connection, Series 10, Program 6. I'm Shirley Adams. Recently, I found some treasures that just begged to be something, even though they were really too small in quantity to be used alone. One was only a half-yard remnant of a handwoven fabric. The other was a still smaller bit of painted leather. The obvious answer is to combine with something compatible, and you can make a complete project. This didn't seem like real serious sewing, so I just had fun with it. Lighten up now and then. Do something uncharacteristic of yourself. This jacket is where that half yard of handwoven fabric went. Now, it was kind of an L-shaped remnant, and this is just the lower part of the L that I put in the jacket. That's all there was to it. The upper part, I was going to use for something else. Well, a half yard now isn't very much, so obviously it had to be a short jacket for starters. Couldn't be anything below waist length, or there wouldn't be enough. And there certainly wasn't enough there for the sleeve, just the body of it was about all I could get away with. So I found in my stash some suede that just went with it, that was nice and compatible. Now in any tweed like this, a hand woven, there are so many colors that it'll blend several different directions. So check either in the shops or in your stash if you have one that is as plentiful as mine. And you can probably find many, many choices. I found in this tweed, for instance, that we had some purple and some bright pink and some kind of dull pink and a little white and some silver, all kinds of different things in it, so it would go several directions really. But I thought the best thing, I didn't want to be too blatant about it, the best thing seemed to be this really soft, subdued pink that I did use. It doesn't show too glaringly because, let's admit, this is a kind of a strange jacket the way it's combined. Now what I started to do is a little embroidery. Remember last show, I showed a slight bit of embroidery. Now this is just some big loose hand woven, and I was using a tapestry needle to go through and get extra patches of colors here and there to do something kind of interesting with it. So that would have been one good choice, and I could certainly do that on what little fabric I had here, by perhaps raveling out some yarns or just using completely separate yarns. Another thought was, how about just weaving that in and out the suede that was going to go with it? So that could be done also. I found that with a tapestry needle, I could just punch in and out of the suede, and that wasn't going to be a problem. It's a thin suede, and it works well. But I decided instead to do something like this. On the little scraps that I had, I just sort of raveled out the edges, so they ravel very nicely. And I can see at least 15 outfits I could make out of all these different colors, mixing with things I already have in my closet or in drawers, because there are so many choices here. But anyway, I did something kind of like this, just sort of raveled it out, and maybe raveled both directions and pulled some of that down, and perhaps take out a little bit, maybe even do a little bit of slashing here and there so that it ravels a little bit better. So whatever you want to do, as I said, this is just playing. It's not serious sewing. This is just a tailored person is probably who I am, actually. But every once in a while, it's fun to do something, just as I said, completely uncharacteristic of yourself. So once I have this kind of raveled out, I put scraps like this on the sleeve, and then arranged them however I thought they might look kind of nice. Don't make it too straight. I have one place here that's really too straight. I need maybe to add something to it because it could stand to be a little more irregular to blend in better. And then if I'd put it on here, I would probably cut the top part of it off just to go with the sleeve. So maybe turn it over and cut a little bit of that off around the top of the sleeve. And then did a little stitching. Now again, this is just quick, easy stitching. There isn't really much to it, so we'll sit down and do a little bit of that. And this stitching I'm going to do maybe just straight stitching, maybe a little bit of zigzag, whatever works. So I'll, big stitches will do, I'll push and make them bigger still, and just do a few rows like that, just so that it won't fall apart. Those stitches will never show. And do as you please. Now I'm using white thread here just so you can see where I've stitched, but you of course would use a blending thread and it'd never show. Or if it seems appropriate, turn it to zigzag instead. Whatever works. And maybe fringe it out a little bit more and stitch a little bit more. And after I had this finished, it still looked too stiff and too set in its ways. So I went a little beyond that and added some to it. So I'll just take off this jacket and show you some of the things that I added. Now, this I started on last program. And what I was doing that last program actually is working with stabilizing it. Come on, jacket, get off. Okay, I was stabilizing that jacket, and to do that, remember around all the cut edges, I had a little bit of fusible interfacing, and I just put little strips around the edge because I didn't want the whole thing stiff. I want this soft and sweatery. So I just needed a little bit of stabilization around the edges. And once that was done, and also last week, remember I was binding the edges with various things. It might have been a bias cut piece of fabric, woven fabric, or it might, in this case, be this fold over, just suede that I have fused on first and then stitched the two outer edges to it so that it binds the edges. No facing did I even use in here. Actually, you can see through this lining a little bit, and if I open it up, you can see that the only place you can see through the lining, the only place I actually have interfacing outside of those little tiny strips stabilizing the edge, the only place is right here where the buttonholes and the buttons are going to be, so that it does provide that extra security and stability for those areas. Anytime you make a suit that's kind of fitted, you better have an ease pleat down the center back, because if you don't have that extra ease there, what will happen when you move, when you reach forward, is of course it'll rip out right here where the sleeves are attached. So do have that ease pleat. But usually at the bottom of linings, I put an ease pleat also down there at the bottom so that it can never kind of pull up. If the dry cleaner, for instance, shrinks it a little bit, that lining can't pull up and make the outside of the jacket look funny. I always do that, except if it has a band anyway, which this one does around the bottom. It's just a little banded jacket. If that lining should pull up a little bit, it really wouldn't matter. It means the blouse or the jacket would blouse, and that's quite all right. Therefore, I didn't put an ease pleat there. I don't want this lining to ever hang down below the little band. So you think through all these things to decide what's going to be the best course of action anytime you do that. Well, on these sleeves, as I started to say, they looked a little bit too set in their way. They didn't look quite casual enough. So I have a little extra, just little pieces of raveled out yarns from this fabric that I'd make little bunches out of and sew those on. And if you look real closely, you can see that there are stitching lines going down here where I just put a little bit more shag there. I might add some more at any point, or you might add some more by putting it on with a needle and doing it by hand. Now, what I also decided after I had it about this far is that it looks like it needs something to blend into the wool too, to blend the two together. When you're combining fabrics, make sure that they do kind of intermingle so they look like they belong together. So what I have done is put all these little fringy things, these little short pieces of suede. And remember I showed you cutting some suede last week by various means. Well, I'll just do it again and show you how quickly you can cut these little strips. Now, these are just scraps left over. Scraps, for instance, this big, not very much at all. And I have two layers here. So I'll just cut some of these little pieces that I'm going to put in. And if I put them right together there and put them on my cutting mat, and I just want little tiny strips, not very wide at all. So I'm going to cut them maybe this narrow. Let's see how that turns out. Yes, quite narrow. And I'll cut not just these two, but a few more. Just keep moving it over to that little edge so that I can easily cut and get a few more going. Anyway, after I have all the strips that I want, then they're going to be put into this jacket. Now, at any point, I can keep putting more. We just recently took a trip, and I had this jacket hanging in the car, so I added a few more. The more we travel, I guess the more strips of it I might have on, the more fringe. But anyway, it's as easy as this. You just fold one of these, not quite in half. Make it a little bit more casual instead of having it too well planned. So a little bit off balance, put it through a tapestry needle. The one I have is smaller. It would be easier if I would use a bigger one still. This one has such a large eye that it's very easy to put that loop through this. And once I get it through, I want to get it into the jacket. And when you do something like this, think of which way it's going to hang. I want that fringe to hang down. Therefore, I'm going to put the needle going down. And just wherever you want to add more, you can just keep adding. So I'm going to put the needle down, and as soon as I get the needle through and pull the little loop through, then I want the needle out of the picture. And I'm just going to put the ends through that loop and pull it tight. And it's on. That's it. That easy. You can do the reverse, too, anytime you decide you don't like this. Of course, it comes off very easily. So once I have that done, there we are, some more fringe. Another way you might do it is with one of these loop turners, the kind that have that little latch hook on the end. And with that, you could very easily just go up through and pull a loop down. And once you have the loop down, then take the little latch away. And here's a better one. Okay, once I have that latch hooked here, I can pull this down through the fabric and get rid of the latch and pull it through. So it's just an easy way to add some fringe. And every once in a while, put a few pieces on, and every once in a while, take a good look and see where you need a little more, where you need it thicker, where you want to shape it in different ways. Think about what are your most prominent parts, what you don't want to show off, or what you do, and maybe get it a little heavier here or there to attract tension, maybe outward on the shoulders. I like to make things like this kind of asymmetrical, kind of unbalanced, because it just blends better. It kind of is interesting that way instead of making it completely balanced. So back and front both. I've only started. I'll probably put more on this. As I said, it's just a fun project. It's not serious sewing, so it really doesn't matter what you do with it. Nice way to blend a couple of little scraps together. Some other things that I might have done with that, there's also a little bit of bright pink here and there woven into this fabric. I have some bright pink suede here. I also have some yarn that goes with it. It's a slightly different texture. This would have been interesting to put in different ways, perhaps embroidering it or maybe couching it on by machine. Couching, remember, I've done before on various other programs, and it's just zigzagging over yarns or cords so that you can attach them to whatever the project is. Well, with this, I might do a little bit more weaving. And I said I'd like to have a loom someday. Well, until I get that loom, I might just do a little weaving through. Now, this is the other part of the fabric. This is the top part of the L that I didn't use in the jacket. Anytime you have tied pieces like this where they joined, you know this is the back of the fabric. So in case it's hard to tell which is the front and the back of a hand woven, because very often by the selvages you can't tell, find where the knots are, wherever they joined on a new yarn, and that's probably the back side. But even then, it doesn't commit you to that side. Now you can notice that the front side is clearer on this. There doesn't seem to be the fuzzy, nappy surface that the back side has. Now usually, the front side of a fabric is nappier than the back. But on this one, the fact that I found all the knots on the napped, the fuzzy surface, makes it look like this is how the weaver intended it to be. So whichever side you use, and I guess this I'll use for the right side, a little weaving here might be fun too. So again, either on the cutting board here or with a rotary cutter, you just cut strips and they can be woven very nicely through this. Again, a tapestry needle does well, both because of the big eye, but also the blunt point, which makes it so easy to weave. And if I wanted to get some of this to blend with it instead of the dull colored suede that I actually used, I would like to just weave a little of this in. And however you want to, it can float over several yarns or it can be a regular weave. But anyway, it's something that goes fast. It's something good to do while you're watching television or if you're the passenger in a car. Or when Aunt Susie calls and you know she's going to talk a good hour, have something like this near the telephone and you can get a whole lot of it done during those long conversations. But you can see how once you weave this in, it really does change the character of the fabric. It changes the apparent color of it because you're adding something to it. And then it would very nicely blend with a skirt or pants or something else of this color so that it looks like it belongs. So get some way to relate it to other fabrics. Something I'm doing with the extra of this, by the way, this bright suede, I only have a small amount of this too. think about children's clothes. There's a little girl on my list who just said recently that she saw the most wonderful vest that was all fringy, and she said, "Can you believe it was pink suede?" And I thought, well, I have some of that in my closet. We'll just do that. So I've cut one out for her, and I just haven't finished it yet. Her two favorite colors are pink and purple, so I'm going to make this one a reversible. I've cut out the pink and the purple, and notice how you can do this if you're using small amounts and making children's clothes. The purple, because of the scraps I had, I cut it out like the pattern. I had to use the front and the back separately. But this pink, I didn't really have enough to waste on the seams. So what I've done here is overlap. And let me just show you how you can do that. As I cut this one out, there's the front and here's the back. And I've overlapped the side seams like this. An inch and a quarter is what this measures, because 5/8 plus 5/8, the two seam allowances, makes an inch and a quarter. So I've just overlapped them. Here's the fold back here, and I've cut them out as one piece. That saves me an inch and a quarter on each side, which I needed since I didn't have a very big piece of suede. But also the fact that there are completely straight lines there on the side seams, there was really no need to have a seam. So it's okay to overlap and combine seams wherever you can. When I put this together later, I will therefore only have a shoulder seam, and that's all. The rest of this little vest will all be in one piece. Now, she said that this vest that was so magnificent was fringed, and that's what made it so good. Well, here's a little gadget that can help for that fringing. It's called, in fact, a fringer. What a unique name for something that fringes. Okay, and here's what I'm going to do with it. I want all this bottom part to be fringed. The waistline of this little vest I see on the pattern is right about here, just a few inches up. Right about here is the waistline, and the rest of it's meant to hang below. So I'm going to put this little gadget on, this fringer, and I need to, of course, get the bottom of it, and I have it on a mat, because you must use something under that cutter. And what this is every quarter inch approximately, there's a little slot through which that blade will go as you cut. So it's an ingenious little thing. You can do the same thing with a ruler, but it's kind of nice to be able to, instead of moving the ruler each time you make a cut, it's kind of nice to have this little thing with all those slots in it. And what they will do is, where shall I start it? Right at the edge, I guess. It's going to have a couple buttons up here, but the rest of it might as well be fringed. So I'll just put it here and line it up so that it's straight with the edge of the vest, with the front edge. And here's how easily you fringe it. You just, I have both layers here together, the top, both fronts together as I'm fringing. So just go through all these slots, or if you want some of this fringe wider, you could skip slots and not do every one of them. But it makes it very easy. Once you get in the swing of it, you could go even faster than what I'm going. And it wouldn't take long at all. Did I already do this one? I did that one. Okay. It wouldn't take long at all to have this whole thing fringed beautifully. Now I'm going to fringe not only the pink side, but I'll do the same with the purple. They are going to be eventually stitched together, and it'll be reversible. Well, if we're going to have a Western look like this on a vest, it might also be nice to put some studs on it, so I'll probably do that. Now these are approximately, as I said, a quarter inch wide. If you wanted a real fine fringe, there's no reason after you do this, there's no reason why you couldn't get them all straight, lay them all out again so they're exactly right. I picked mine up so it's hard to get it straight, and put this on and just offset it halfway and make that a real fine fringe by doing all the cutting again. So check out the new things that come on the market. Go to your local stores and see what's available, and see what's going to help you as you sew. Okay, well, this was one project, using little bits of suede and hand wovens and seeing how we could make something new out of those. I have some other projects, though, that I have going. Now, here's one that's kind of fun. You saw modeled on the first show of this series a jacket, and I'll get back to that jacket later, by the way, because I'm going to be doing some extra work with it, so I'll talk to you about it. I'll tell you what it's all about. Where'll I get rid of this? Just over the chair, I guess. I'll tell you about this fabric later, this cotton that I have here for a background. But here's the little scrap that I had left over from the jacket that you saw modeled and you will see explained again later in the series. And what this fabric is, it's cotton actually, it's a knit, and I have it fused to a backing here, some fleece, some fusible fleece, or else use a fusible release sheet and some regular fleece to fuse the two together. But what this whole shape is going to be is a bag. They're summer purses. They will wash nicely because everything in it's washable, so once it gets soiled it can just be swished through soapy water and cleaned. But what it's going to be when it's all finished is a bucket bag. Now maybe you remember back in series 9 we did bucket bags, and over here on the table I have a couple of bucket bags to show you what they look like. Here's a brand new one that I just made, and here's one that you actually saw on series 9. And these bucket bags, even though they're kind of big shoulder bags, they only take a half yard of fabric, and so that isn't much. What that half yard looks like, let me get the pattern out here for it. It's simply a rectangle of fabric, and it isn't all that big, so it's a nice project when you do just have a small amount of fabric. Okay, it's this big. This part right here is what it is. So I'm going to use that part, and that's what I have cut out down here, and I have all this extra, these little scraps of suede on it. And what I've done with them already is fuse them in place. Now notice how I took a lot of suede scraps, various colors, just pale colors, pastels here, and I first had wide scraps. I fused some fusible release sheet to the backside, cut these little strips, irregular sizes, and I've put them all along here and fused them in place. Anytime you fuse this suede down, be sure that you use a press cloth, of course, because you can't put the iron directly on this suede. It'll alter the surface in a way that you don't want it to look. So, to do this, you just put the strips down however you want these strips to be, peel off the backing, put them down in place, and once you have them all arranged to your liking, then you go ahead and fuse them. I haven't fused the ends here yet since I was waiting to show you how to do this, but get them all straightened out and then put the press cloth on and go ahead and press, and they will be permanently down here. If you don't want to do any more stitching, be sure you use a heavy duty fusible on it. This I am going to stitch so it isn't. But once it's all down in place here, what I'm going to do then, as you can see I've done on other strips, is just stitch each edge. So put it all down first, then do all your stitching, and it's just right along edge stitching. Find a place on your press or foot where you can do a nice straight line on the edge. After I have this piece all fused, what I've done is put a little irregular shape kind of on each side up and down. I've then put a little binding there which I will eventually turn under. What's going to happen to this then is it will come into a bucket shape. It will come into a cylinder like this, and there will be stitched to the bottom of it this little oval that goes on the bottom that's exactly the right size. And then I saw this little cord, this tasseled rope, and I have it upside down, let's put it right side up, in an upholstery shop, and I thought that is just right for this. Now you have to think your way through and figure how can you do, what's first, what's second, and so on when you do something like this. I figured that I had to get this strap on right now before I actually sew the seam in here and before I put the bottom on. So think your way through, but it's going to be kind of a nice bag, and the whole thing is washable, so it will go through some cleaning very easily later on. Another one I'm making out of a little scrap is just putting various scraps of woven fabrics on and zigzagging them in place, since they do have a ravelly edge and can't be straight stitched. They'll be zigzagged. Well, fun to make these little bags. I have a couple more things over here on the table that will become bags. Now this one we're going to work with next week. Now remember I said right at the start of this program that I had a piece of painted leather. Well, here's the painted leather. It was only this big That's not a very big piece. That's only about 7 inches perhaps long or high, and maybe about 14, 16 inches wide. Well, I really like that little piece of leather, but it wasn't big enough to do anything I wanted to do with it. So this is the same bag, and it's just putting a strip on the top and on the bottom to enlarge it, to make it higher, putting a couple of strips on the ends, and then making it into a bag. Something else I have that I really like is this antique piece. It's really a pillow cover. It's from India. And I thought, this is going to make a good bag. Think what other precious little piece you have that you can do something with. This one will just fold in half. I'll combine it with some suede or leather, and it'll make a nice fold-over handbag. Another one that I have is going to be leather with some ribbon on it. A whole lot of things you can do out of just small amounts of fabric. Well, the outside of this bag was really fun to make, to fuse together and put it all together. But next time, come join me, and we're going to look inside to discover how you can make a compartmentalized purse to keep all your belongings separated so that there are several sections to put everything in. Come back and join me then.